Only a few good hearts in this real cold world. Where's the love and everyone being equal? Only a few good people in this real cold world. Officer Norman, you are one of those people. So here's a letter to you. Thank you for all you have done. From showing love to showing kids who they can really become. Life is way much deeper than skin. I hope you take the time to really meet the person within. Dedicating your whole life to inspire the youth. Imagine if more human beings were doing that too. We'd have way less tears and more celebrations. I'm talking less funerals and more graduations. Keep a smile to the end. Never settle, never follow no trends. The way you move the world, you gotta be heaven sent. You taught us when the world stops spinning, you gotta keep pedaling. A few good hearts in this real cold world. Where's the love in everyone being equal? A few good people in this real cold world. Officer Norman, you are one of those people. Only a few good hearts in this real cold world. Where's the love in everyone being equal? Only a few good people in this real cold world. Officer Norman, you are one of those people. So here's a letter to you. Thank you for all of your work. From showing love to showing kids what they can really be worth. Shout out to Game of Harlem too. That's more good souls. No matter your skin tone, you can shine like gold. You can meet life goals. You can go make a difference. Cause we don't look alike, doesn't mean that we're different. Keeping the spirits high when the times get rough. Keeping the hope alive without a thing but love. A living legend is saying the least. Throughout the bad you never failed and kept spreading the peace. Throughout it all you kept spreading the hope. Throughout it all you kept communities close. Continue doing what you do, always hope for the best. You showed you can have a heart with a badge on your chest. Continue doing what you do, always hope for the best. You showed you can have a heart with a badge on your chest. Thank you for all you have done. From showing love to showing me who I can really become. Thank you for all of your work. From showing love to showing me what I can really be worth. J-Tuck.
Okay, so before I turn it over, just keep in mind that you're learning tonight more about the man, the mission, and the legacy he's creating. So, furthermore, I'm turning over to Callie and our distinguished lecturer, Officer Tommy Norman.
We pass this mic over to you.
Yay, here we go.
Okay, so I'd like to start this with, I mean, we all know who you are. I mean, we see you on social media. We're from North Little Rock. We know exactly who you are, but we don't know your day-to-day life, like what it's like to be out of your uniform and in your uniform and how you distinguish both of those between the two.
Well, really, first of all, I want to thank Lauren, the university police department, and everybody that came out. It really means a lot to me. I love coming to Northwest Arkansas. I'm a big Razorback fan, and just to be here for the next several days, it's a big, big honor. So thank you from the bottom of my heart. So, you know, it's really hard for me to separate work and I guess my off time, because really as a giver, as someone who's committed to making a difference, really there's really not an on and off button. It stays on because when you're a giver, you can even be at home giving. You know, you can call someone and check on them, you know, and so I guess if there ever is much off time for me, I just like to sit back and relax and eat donuts. No, I'm just joking. But you know, watch the Razorbacks. I'm a big St. Louis Cardinals fan, and I'm a pretty simple person.
Okay, so can you tell me a little bit about why you decided to become a police officer?
You know, initially, first of all, I wanted to be a police officer in North Little Rock, born and raised in North Little Rock. So I wanted to be a police officer really in my backyard, so to speak. And so initially my reason for being a police officer was, I think typically what most police officers would say, to, you know, rid the streets of crime and drugs, or at least do my part in doing that, and just make it a safer community to live in, which is a big part of being a police officer. But that changed really, really quick, and I'll share that later.
Okay, and what does it mean to be an agent of change? And what does an agent of change mean to you?
You know, we were talking to some of my friends earlier whenever we were having a conversation about being an agent of change. But to be an agent of change, it's a very humbling experience. It keeps me grounded. Because being an agent of change, you have a platform to impact people's lives. Whether you're a police officer, whether you work at a fast food restaurant, it doesn't matter what you do or what your occupation is, the opportunity is there and the platform is there. So there's really no excuses for anyone here not to be an agent of change because, first of all, it doesn't cost anything to have a heart.
True. Now, you said something about being humble and grounded. I mean, we all know he has 1.2 million followers on Instagram. How do you stay humble and grounded when you have so many people watching and following you?
Really, to have 1.2 million followers is flattering, but that's not what makes me. Right? That's not what it's. Social media is fun. I do acknowledge that God has placed me on a huge platform to inspire other people across the world. But I'm on the inside looking out, whether you're on the outside looking in. And so the way I view it is all the attention I'm receiving and all of these accolades, I shouldn't be, because I'm just being nice. I'm a police officer that's being kind to people, right? And you really shouldn't receive the attention. But I am, so I take it in stride, and I take advantage of it in some very positive methods.
Now, do you think that the social media and the followers has changed the way that you do your job, or have you stayed the same throughout the thing?
I can remember when my kids told me about Facebook and social media, and my son says, "Dad, you should start a Facebook page." I didn't know what Facebook was, and so I posted a selfie, and then I posted another picture, and I was really big on selfies at first, and so anyway. And so then I took it to, being a police officer, took a couple of pictures with kids in the community, and then I went to videos, and I don't know, just so many people across the world, I think, that wanted to see hope and promise in the world of police officers. They located my social media page, and really a lot of people share the work that I do, and it's not just me, you know, it's the entire community there where I live in North Little Rock. And so, but it is, it's exciting. You know, you have people all over the world that reach out to me, that contact me, that send boxes and packages in from Australia, from China, and just from everywhere. And so literally the eyes of the world are watching, you know, the work that's done there in Central Arkansas.
And does that ever make you feel nervous about what you're doing? How do you stay excited about what you're doing if there's negativity? Because there's always going to be negativity online.
It doesn't affect me. You know, 13 years old is when I really started my mission, I guess my movement, so to speak. So when you eat it and you sleep it and you drink it, I mean, there's nothing nothing is going to stop you when you're really committed to changing the world.
Very cool. Okay, so tell me a little bit about hashtag community policing and hashtag stay committed.
You know, community policing, a lot of people ask me, what is community policing? You know, so to me, community policing is getting out of your police car. So in North Little Rock, if you see my police car, I'm probably not going to be inside of it. You know, I'm probably going to be in the neighborhoods, walking, sitting on front porches. You know, that's community policing. Two key components to me when it comes to community policing is forming relationships, but even bigger than that is staying committed to those relationships. The areas that I patrol are downtown North Little Rock, which, you know, I choose those areas. They're areas that most of the front yards are dirt instead of grass, and some of the homes are in really bad shape. Those people, the people that live in that community, they're special people. And sometimes they need a little more hope and promise because of personal situations that they're dealing with, and that's where my policing comes into play. As a police officer, it's really important that your badge have a heartbeat and not an ego. And so I take a lot of pride in that. I remember the job I worked before I became a police officer, a really good friend of mine, he was concerned that once I became a police officer, I was going to change who I was. I was going to get this big head, and the authority that I was going to gain was going to change me as a person. But I can honestly say that I've remained humble, you know, throughout it all.
Very cool. Well, now how unique is your approach to your community policing? Because I know that some of your other officers are community police officers,
right,
as well. What is unique about you compared to everyone else?
With me, and I've thought about this, I feel like it's more of a gift. You know, God's really blessed me with the gift of connecting with people. And it's really hard to explain, but I have a connection with people of all ages, of all races. And really my goal is for people that most of society will turn their back on, that's why I'm gonna show up at their front door. You know, some people that maybe look different than others, you know, they smell different. You know, it's just people that other people would drive by and not even take a second look at. But as a police officer that's committed to change, that's what I'm going to show up. So,
did you always have this big of a heart, like even when you were a little kid?
13 years old, growing up in North Little Rock, I mowed grass. That's how I made extra money. One day I came home with about $60 in my pocket. And I turned on the TV, and there's a program called Feed the Children, where they give you a chance to send money to another country to feed a child and clothe a child. In return, they'll send you a picture and a bio of the child that you sponsored. And so it really captured my heart. So I go to my mom, I give her $60, I give the address to send the money to, and she looks at me really funny. Because at 13 years old, with $60, you're gonna go probably to the mall and buy something with it. And so from that point on, the giving never stopped. I was always trying to find ways to, I remember I wanted to volunteer for Meals on Wheels, and I was only 14. And so my mom would have to drive me to CareLink, pick up 15 hot meals and with a list of addresses, and she would drive me to each home. I would get out, and I wore my mom out. She did a lot of driving. And so anyway, and so, but there you have it. And so, but as a police officer, there's no excuses. A police officer shouldn't be out there making a difference. When you put on that uniform, you're a hero, right? When I go speak to a group of kids, they're not looking at me, they're looking at my gun belt and my boots and my badge. You're a real life hero that they can actually reach out and meet. And so when you put on that uniform and you have that hero status, the opportunities to make a difference are in the hundreds and thousands, you know. And so there's so many ways to really captivate a community as a police officer.
Can you tell me a little bit more about your mission, Give?
It's a foundation actually I created because of the GoFundMe from the artist The Game and his son Harlem. And so one of my dreams has always been to really have my own foundation. And so basically the goal is the same. It's just with my foundation, it's not a connection to the police department. It's me, it's a group of board members, and pretty much it's the same mission: change people's lives, impact lives of people that really need that hope and that promise.
Now, how did you know The Game, and how did you get associated with all of that?
It's been crazy. You know, it was a Sunday when people were sending me text messages and direct messages, and hey, the rapper The Game started to GoFundMe, and you know, I was actually at work that day, and sure enough, he did. His son Harlem was talking to his dad about being disturbed about, you know, police relations with community members. And so anyway, they Googled positive policing, North Little Rock Police Department showed up, and then the rest is history. So about $74,000 that was raised, over 3,000 people donated money through the GoFundMe. So, you know, and what's really powerful is that The Game was never really a big fan of police officers. And for that to happen, to me, is a really powerful story.
Now, you talk about leading with your heart and how important relationships are. Can you tell me about how you build those relationships with all of your community?
Just commitment every day. And when my shift ends at 2, it's not over. You know, you have to grind every day. You have to really, I tell people, put your heart in hustle mode. You know, and it's a commitment that you really, really have to take serious. I take my policing very, very seriously. A lot of people in the communities that I patrol in North Little Rock have dealt with broken promises all their life. And I don't want to be one of those officers that breaks a promise as far as staying in their life. And you think about it, as a police officer in the community that's committed, you'll form relationships, but you'll be viewed really more as a family member or a friend. You know, I tell people I've been invited to a whole lot of cookouts, right? I sit on a lot of front porches. I can go to North Rock right now and sit on any front porch and there's no questions asked, because those front porches really become your front porch as a community police officer. You'll be invited to birthday parties. You'll be invited to graduations. You'll be invited to hospitals where children are going to have surgery. Your family, so you're going to be invited to all of those events, and you should show up to every one of them. Right, you should really show up. I don't care what it is. If you're tired, you had a long day, if you get invited to a birthday party for a 4-year little girl, you better show up. And so I don't call it, I really don't say it's a lot of work, mm-hmm. it's just, you're there. You're part of that family, so it's part of that commitment.
Do you think that that's affected any of your personal or family life?
I mean, it's taken me away from, you know, I'm the youngest. There's nine of us. I have a twin sister, and there's six girls and three boys. So all you ladies with all those moods you get in, I'm a pro with those, so bring it on. So, you know, and my mom really raised us herself. You know, my dad wasn't really involved in my life, and so, you know, they knew from 13 years old up until now that I wasn't going to be at home as much probably as my other siblings because I wanted to go out and make a difference.
I just think your whole story and everything about you is just so incredible.
I appreciate it.
Very, very incredible. Well, can you tell me a little bit more about any challenges that you face? What is the biggest challenge that you've had to overcome from all of this?
Initially, it was jealousy. You know, when you are committed to change and some people's views aren't their views. But as I gained more self-confidence and as a more seasoned officer who was out making a difference, you know, I didn't really let that affect me. You know, really, I guess the only other challenges is that, you know, maybe individuals that you've really committed yourself to that still make the wrong choices in life and you've done your part. And so it's something that not everyone that you come into contact with is going to follow the example that you set for them.
How do you deal with some of that negativity for people who do not support you?
Really, it just motivates me to do even more, to go out and make a bigger difference and go above and beyond even higher than what I've been doing.
But I'm sure you receive more support rather than not
support. Right. People are supportive, and so people from all over the world, you know, they fall in love with these people that I feature on my social media pages, from Lois to Maya, and from everybody. Lois is 71 years old. She thinks we're dating. But I'll say this, you know, when you're an agent of change and you're really involved in changing the community, if it takes a 71-year-old woman to think that we're dating to make the last years of her life enjoyable, then I'm okay with that.
Do you have any advice for other people, for other agents of change?
Just, you know, don't skip a day. You know, some people say, well, if you're not at work, how do you make a difference? Well, what I do is throughout my years of patrol, I have a notebook, and people that I meet, I write down their names and their addresses and their phone numbers. So maybe if it's a day I want to take a break and just relax, which is rare, I'll pull out that notebook and I'll call people. So just think about, you're at home, or maybe you're wherever you're at, and you get a call from that police officer that patrols your community. That's big. Two-minute conversation. So there's so many ways. So, you know, it's really powerful to talk about. And I really feel like that, you know, it's working. You know, the years of commitment really paid off.
Now, do you think that there's other police officers similar to you?
I'll say this, 99% of police officers all over the world are great police officers. Mm-hmm. I was asked, I went to St. Louis last week. I met with the new Ferguson chief of police, from St. Louis police officers, and a gentleman asked me, what happened to Officer Friendly? Well, Officer Friendly never went away. Officer Friendly has remained here, but the media has kind of pushed Officer Friendly to the back, right? Police officers everywhere do the same work that I do, I feel. And just because they don't post their work on social media doesn't mean they're not effective. I realize that the platform that I have, obviously, I should take advantage of it and really keep inspiring people.
Do you think that you, in general, have changed other police departments?
I've had other police agencies reach out to me, from Atlanta Police Department to other smaller police departments. And, you know, last week when I spoke to probably a group of 30 police officers in St. Louis County, you know, I gave them pretty much the same advice I would give any police department, and just really simple ways to go out and make a difference. And some of those officers shared with me later that, you know, it really changed their views of how they police their community, and it motivated them to go out and make a difference.
What gives you the most joy of your work?
Just knowing that people trust me. Just a real quick story. So I was hired in 1998. In 2001, a gentleman called the downtown substation in North Rock and asked to speak with me. He was in Little Rock at a gas station at 9th and I-30. So I go there. He's sitting on a curb in front of the gas station. He's a homeless man, and he said he wanted to turn himself in because the police were looking for him because he committed a homicide. He actually had beat a man with a 2x4 in a homeless camp in the woods. So I called Little Rock Police. They send their officers over, their detectives over. They even look at the bottom of the guy's shoes, and there's blood on the bottom of his shoes from the crime scene. So they put him in the back of their patrol car, but I walk over and ask the gentleman, you know, why me? You know, when I got out of my car, he looked at me. He looked at my name badge because people told him I was a black guy. I have a good tan. So anyway, and so I asked him, why? You never even met me before, but you got tired of running from the police. He said that the word on the street was that there was a police officer in North Little Rock that he could surrender to with dignity and respect. So as a 3-year officer, if I ever questioned, was community policing working, that answered it right there.
What an incredible story. Well, what's next? I mean, now that you've done all this, what's coming up next?
Nothing changes for me. I'll go right back to North Little Rock. I'll go right there in the backyard of my community, and I keep dancing. Dancing. I know I can't dance. I looked at that video. I was like, I'm a terrible dancer. But I'll go back to work Monday. I'm going to spend 4 days in Fayetteville. Woo, go Hawks. Anyway, Monday morning when I report to duty at 5:45, I'm going to go out. I'm going to visit bus stops. I'm going to go form more relationships. It won't stop for me. And I always ask myself, will I wake up one morning and will that be it? Will the passion be gone? Will I want to try something else? And every day I wake up at 4:30, it's like day one for me. It's like I just graduated from rookie school and I'm ready to hit the ground running. So I give thanks to God. I give thanks to my mom for really teaching us to put others first, even if that means that we have to do without. And so the drive and the fire is still there. And I don't know if that it'll ever go away.
Well, thank you so much. I think we're going to move on to the Q&A now.
I love meeting new people. You know, the University Police Department, I'm a little envious that you're here on the hill with the Hogs, but that's okay. I've got North Rock High School down there, so that's like our... And so anyway, but... And really, to try to explain this where it makes sense, but I still view other officers as I did when I was a kid. So I look up to those guys right there. I do. I mean, I know it may seem a little odd, but I do. I mean, when I see other officers, I view them as I did when I was a little 6 or 7 year old kid. They're still heroes to me. So, I work with heroes. And so I just encourage you, when you leave here tonight and tomorrow when you wake up, I hope I've inspired you to really go out and at least impact a life. And I was never the smartest growing up, never the brightest. I didn't know a whole lot, but what got me to each step in life was my heart. What got me here tonight was my heart. You know, there's nothing spectacular about me. I wanted to be the next Michael Jordan. I love that man. I baked a cake on his birthday, which is February 17th. I did. And that cake, it molded and it got thrown in the trash. I ate one piece. I remember when they won the championship and I worked at an auto parts store and I took shoe polish and, Chicago Bulls champs or whatever. And then I was determined to be the next Michael Jordan, so I shaved my head. I chewed, because Michael Jordan always chewed a wad of gum when he played basketball, and he wagged his tongue. So one day at Burns Park in North Little Rock, I'm playing basketball. I've got my Jordan 23 on, and I'm wagging my tongue, and I bite a hole in it. So I decided then to be the Michael Jordan, or at least try to be the Michael Jordan community policing. And so there you have it. And so, really, it doesn't matter where you're from. It doesn't matter how nice the house is that you live in. It doesn't matter how nice your car is. It doesn't matter the kind of clothes you wear. What matters when God takes you away from here is the way you treated people and how you impact people's lives. And so, but I'm ready for, I guess, the Q&A.
All right, so first question. What's one thing that you know now that you wish you would have known when you were of college age?
Is that for me?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Can I sit down? Just the importance of giving, the importance of leading with your heart, and really how it can impact people's lives. When you're kind to people and maybe you don't get the reaction that you think you would, they're going to remember that. The kindness goes a long way.
So expound on the point of leading with your heart. What does that look like? What does that feel like?
Well, you know, as a police officer, when you park your police car and you step out, you know, boots to the ground, and when you lead with your heart, you know, it's not about, you know, raising your voice. It's not about being disrespectful to people. It's about treating you the way you want to be treated. Right, and to me, that's leading with your heart, showing people compassion, showing people respect, and showing people dignity.
So what's one life lesson you've learned that you could share with us that doesn't relate to being a police officer?
That family comes first, and not just the family that you grew up with, but family members that you may meet through your job that become members of your family. You know, life is short, so, you know, love your friends, love the people that are close to you, you know, and don't wait too late.
So we know you love the Hawks. So someone said, give us a prediction for Saturday's game.
I've already given this prediction, and it's on my Instagram. If you think I'm making it up, you can go back and play a video from McDonald's the other day. But Arkansas 31, Alabama 27.
31-27. Go Hawks.
Remember that story, score, Cannon. All right.
Absolutely, Cannon. Don't duck out on us now. So you normally talk about a positive word of the day. So what's your positive word for today?
Change.
Okay. It says, in regards to citizen and police relations, talk about why social media.
Social media, I mean, it's really powerful. You know, you can use it as a platform. It can be good or bad, as you know. You know, being a police officer now, cell phones, you know, and people are always recording me, whether I'm on a traffic stop or wherever. People, I always have their phones out, and I think you should know that. But really, social media, it's really placed me in a position that in 1998 I never thought I would be in. If somebody told me that in 1998 that I was going to receive national, international attention as a police officer, but all that's from social media. If it wasn't for social media, I wouldn't be here right now, you know. And so social media is really, really powerful. And you can impact lives using social media, and people are just really drawn to that.
Absolutely. So your community policing methods have worked so well in North Little Rock. If Officer Tommy Norman had a magic wand, knowing that you have a healthy disregard for the impossible, how could you spread what it is that you're doing nationally and globally?
I guess if I had a magic wand, it would be for, as I said before, every person, you know, across the globe to go volunteer. Volunteering is very important. And that's really where I started. You know, I volunteered with Meals on Wheels and, you know, Paint Your Heart Out and you know, taking people that are visually impaired to shop and volunteer for hospice. So volunteering is something that you should really really maybe give it a try if you don't already, and just really being that advocate for people that can't speak up. There's a lot of people that you see on my social media. Davey was born with meningitis. He can hear, but he can't speak. And other people that really need you to be their voice and to stand ground for them.
So I just got a text message.
From Michael Jordan?
No. From Mr. Juan Robles, who said, please ask my question. So the question is, not Apple verification. How do you interact with community members whose native language is not English? How does this challenge your mission?
It's going to sound funny, but I go to Shipley's Donuts every morning. And the people that run the donut shop, they're from Cambodia. You know, that they don't speak the best English, and so, but my relationship with them, it's so positive, you know. And so I think that a lot of times, if someone doesn't speak the same language that I do, our hearts, you know, kind of are kind of the connecting point, you know, when it comes to actually connecting with them. So
this is from our great leader of the Center for the Multicultural and Diverse Education. Says, your original inspiration, Lawrence Timer, is terrible. Just kidding. Your original inspiration was to rid the streets of crime and drugs, but that quickly changed when you actually became an officer. What was the catalyst for that change?
So I wanted to give community policing a try. So I went to the police academy, and the beginning of my career, I worked like midnight shift, and community policing on midnight shift, I mean, it's a little difficult because most people are asleep. And so when I was finally put on a shift where I could actually meet people, I would park my police car and I would walk down the side streets. And at first, people would go, and if they were sitting outside, they would go inside their homes because they weren't really used to this new police officer in the neighborhoods. But I would go back the next day and the next day and the next day, and more people would come on their front porches. Kids would come out and talk to me. I remember I would walk, and there would be two or three kids on each side of me, and the next day there'd be four or five, and after a few months there was a line of kids here and a line of kids here, and we took up the whole block. But that's because I promised myself that I would stay committed to the community. And when I saw the reaction from people that maybe we didn't trust the police initially, when they know that you're there to stay and you're not going to go anywhere, then the relationship can really improve.
So we're going to take two questions, one from each side of the audience. So if you have a burning question that you want to get answered, I'm going to let Lauren be the person that chooses.
That's a great person to choose. Right here in the corner. All right, so we are. All right, I'm passing you the mic, sir.
Hey, how everybody doing? My name is Sedante Cole, Officer Norman. I met you earlier. All right, you mentioned when you first started, a part of your campaign was just to get out the car and probe the streets. At any time, did you fear for your safety? You know, you weren't too familiar with the area and you were just walking.
Well, but what really benefited me is that I'm from North Little Rock. I ran the same streets that I patrol in, so a lot of people knew me, but not as a police officer. So I think initially that just because you're from a community and now you're policing that community, you're still going to have to prove yourself. So I think initially I was a little bit reluctant because I wasn't a seasoned police officer. Some of the areas in North Little Rock are high crime areas. But through each year and through staying committed now, I'll go into any neighborhood, you know, with no questions asked, just because of so many years of trust and respect. But initially, yes, I was a little fearful.
All right, thank you. Next question on this side.
So my brother is a police officer in a gang-affiliated area in Little Rock, and something that we always talk about is how he can do something like what you're doing, but he doesn't know how to get started. Do you have any kinds of recommendations or if it could even work in those types of areas?
It's not going to happen quickly, but you also have to take the approach to where they don't just need to see you when something bad happens. You need to show up when you're not busy and get out and talk to them. And there may be a few that may turn their back and walk away, but you can't give up, right? As a committed community police officer, if there's one person that sticks around and you engage in a conversation. And I think it's really important as a police officer, show up when nothing's going on, not just when the police are called. So, but it's a challenge. You said it's your brother, and it is a challenge, but I really feel like that he'll realize eventually that once he gets out there, and what's really important is that, so people ask me, are you a real police officer? I mean, do you write tickets and take people to jail? They think I just go around and kiss babies and hug people all day, but my gun is full of bullets. I went through the police academy, and that's the thing about it. There's some days that I can't, community police because I'm busy answering calls and taking reports. But even if there's only 2 minutes out of those 8 hours of my shift to get out of my car and shake someone's hand and just start a conversation, then that right there at least is a start. So I would encourage him to just baby step, so to speak.
Okay, thank you for the volunteers. Also, before we end, Officer Tommy Norman, can you choose two more volunteers out of the crowd to answer their questions?
You mean you just pick somebody to ask a question?
No. So anybody else that has any questions, raise your hand.
Oh, okay.
All right. And he's going to pick the next two, the last two.
Because I was going to pick Cannon and is Amber still here? Amber left?
Cannon's not off the hook.
I've known Amber since she was about 4 years old. She used to call me Ossifer Norman.
Oh, that's so sweet.
I'm not going to go anymore with that, Amber. You in the red hat. I think that internally, you know, if you have your chief, our chief Mike Davis, you know, he set the example for me because he's pretty much a pioneer, almost 30 years of law enforcement there. And so, you know, I think it really it begins at the top. So if you have someone that's a leader of your department, you know, they have a big role to play as far as how his police officers or her police officers police that community. And so we have a positive example to follow by our chief. But, you know, with other people, you ask what other people feel like they're being targeted. You know, I think that's where you have police officers that really have built that trust and respect, and then I think that they should be sent into those neighborhoods to kind of calm those fears. There's going to be several police officers in each police department that are going to be assigned to neighborhoods that are troubled neighborhoods because of the rapport that they've built with that community. And so it's really important that each police officer get out through that. And community policing is not for every police officer. That doesn't make him a bad police officer. In each police department, there's different components that form, you know, a positive team, so to speak. So I hope that answered your question, son.
So I got another text message. It said urgent, so I don't want to get in trouble. It says, how can other officers and community members move from seeing police as symbols of horror to an image of a real hero as yourself?
As I've been talking about the entire night, it's just how you change that image. It's just being viewed at beyond that uniform, beyond that police car. You know, it's real important that people know that just because you're a police officer and you wear that uniform, you are a person of authority. You have a lot of authority to take people's freedom away if they break the law, but at the same time, they need to see you beyond that. They need to see you showing dignity and showing respect and compassion. But it's all about commitment. So if you go into a neighborhood today, you need to come back tomorrow and the next day and the next day. And once they see you, that image of you will change into something positive.
So Cannon, now is your time. So just tell us briefly what Officer Norman means to you.
Well, Officer Norman means, he's a great individual. I got to know him through one of my great friends, Rosalind Godden, who we went to, kindergarten on from obviously 5 years old till now. We're still great friends. She actually graduated in high school. She went to UCA and she was only there for like a year. And she was like, I got to come up to the University of Arkansas because you're there and I know it's great. It's going to be better than UCA. So it was like that one little small part of our lives. She was like, "Well, I can't be away from you, so I'm coming up to the University of Arkansas." Like I said, that's one of my great friends, and I actually got to know Tommy Norman through her, which has been a real impact on my life. One thing I wanted to talk about, since Adrian kind of blasted me in the beginning of this session, how North Little Rock police officers actually impacted me. As a small kid, I had two officers that just come to mind, and those two officers were Officer Yielding and Officer Bona. Those officers impacted me because, one, Officer Bona used to come to our elementary school multiple times a week, and he was a positive influence on just kids in the elementary school. Growing up in North Little Rock, Arkansas, Rose City area to be exact, Metal Park, actually. You see police officers, but they're really just riding around. But those type of police officers got out their cars, and it just didn't start with Officer Norman. It's been going on for a long time, I feel like. They got out, they used to talk to us, they would let us get in their cars, shoot the gun as far as people speeding, and if they were speeding, they'd say, okay, you gotta get out. It's time for us to go get them. And then loop back around and we'd get in there and do it again. So, I mean, it would be stuff, just little small things like that after school, as far as things like that. It also kind of kept us out of trouble. They kept us out of trouble. We would still, I'm kind of incriminating myself, but we would still do bad things as far as shoot firecrackers at each other, dumb stuff, and actually run. But then the police would always catch us and be like, hey, why did you do that? And sit down and talk to us. And we'd be like, well, I don't know. I'm a kid and I'm being dumb. But anyway, small things like that. I was actually a part of what was called the Police Athletic League, which I feel like impacted me a lot. I played football, basketball, and baseball for those guys. And actually, I became the president later on when I was in middle school of what was the Police Athletic League Council. That took me to Disney World for free. I got to see a lot of different things that coming from North Little Rock, Arkansas, Meadow Park area, I didn't ever think I would see. Going to Disney World for free, like I said, sitting down in those council meetings, talking to other people all around the nation that were my age. Some of them were a little bit older, but just those police officers actually taking the time out, impacting my life, showing me different things, showing me that there's more. And to where I am now, obviously being alumni of the University of Arkansas and now an associate for Walmart. So like I said, it didn't just start with Officer Norman. He's continuing what other officers did in the past as far as great things in North Rock, Arkansas. So.
Thank you, Cannon. So Officer Norman, I'm gonna give you an opportunity for any closing words or thoughts.
Just know that I think a lot of the university, I actually went to Nolan Richardson's basketball camp years ago, 3 years in a row. And so to me, this is such a prestigious university, just coming to Northwest Arkansas. So thank you for who you are and who you represent. Just know that there's a police officer in North Little Rock that thanks the world of this university. And so keep representing this university. You know, you have a platform as well. If I can do it, you can do it. I'm telling you, there was nothing special about me ever growing up. It was always my heart. And so if I can impact not just Arkansas, but people across the world, you can do the same thing. But you can't wait. The time is now. The time is now. And it's not that people want you. People need you. And so do we have to end? Can we stay a few more hours? No, but thank you so much. This is absolutely amazing. Yeah, I was telling Lauren, I went to St. Louis last week and throughout the first pitch at Busch Stadium, and it was such a big honor. But this is home. Arkansas is home. So you can't beat that. So thank you so much.
So on behalf of the Center for Multicultural and Diverse Education, we just want to say thank you for coming out tonight, giving you your time, coming to hear from Officer Norman. Again, tonight was focusing on the man, the mission, and the legacy. And what I want to say is that's no different than you. You have an opportunity to create a legacy. And again, it starts now. So on behalf of the University of Arkansas, I personally want to say thank you for taking out of your busy schedule to come here and share with us your thoughts.
I wouldn't have missed it. Thank you so much.
Last, go ahead, clap. Go ahead. So last but not least, I would like to thank all the departments and organizations that helped this become possible. I would like to thank our host, Callie Barkwell. Everyone give her a round of applause, please. And also, I tried to get to all the questions that we could. Just let y'all know there will be a brief meet and greet right out here with light refreshments. So again, thank you all for coming. And if you do not follow him on social media, feel free to follow him on social media.
T Norman 23. Watch me dance, watch me whip, watch me nay-nay.
And watch his philosophy. Thank you all. Have a great night.